The church in crisis. Are people losing faith? In the interview, the head of the German Bishops' Conference, Robert Zollitsch.
Excellency, you are chair of the German Bishops' Conference. How badly has the recent string of abuse cases in German boarding schools and Catholic and monastic schools affected the church?
I was very shaken by the affair. I couldn't have imagined it. The extent of everything we've been through shows how bad it was. Abuse is awful, and doubly so when perpetrated by clergy. We're shocked and doing everything we can to clarify things.
Und deswegen ist auch die Betroffenheit bei uns sehr groß. Und darum versuchen wir auch all das, was uns möglich ist, zur Aufklärung beizutragen. Und
Prevention will be important across the whole of society to stop this happening again. We want to pass on to others what we've developed as preventative measures. We want to help, not just ourselves. But first, we have to examine ourselves.
Weil wir allen helfen wollen, nicht nur uns selber, aber zuerst schauen wir auf uns.
The standing and the authority of the Catholic Church have taken a blow this year. Estimates are that up to 200,000 Catholics might leave the Church. Has the abuse scandal permanently damaged the foundation of the Church, or will it pass?
We don't have any definite numbers yet, but I do hope that they are much lower than your forecast. It does affect the church, but a large portion of the people leaving were those who were already feeling removed. There are those who found it appalling and are saying, I'm leaving out of disappointment. And that is a loss for us because each person that leaves the church hurts us, because we want to take as many people as possible down the path of faith. But the foundation of our church is Jesus Christ. That is what carries us. We want to begin afresh. We have to, and we do admit this terrible thing, but we also want to look forward. We need to help people gain confidence from their faith and not get mired in disappointment and sorrow.
Archbishop Zollitsch, is it perhaps the case that the Pope could have been more helpful, particularly since he's a German Pope, even though that isn't the most important designation for the head of the Universal Catholic Church?
Of course, I spoke with Pope Benedict about all these cases. He's been very shocked by it all. His remarks on abuse show that. He wrote a pastoral letter to the congregation in Ireland. It demonstrates his pain. Of course, he is not the type to present himself to the media, unlike his predecessor in his good years. We shouldn't forget that John Paul was an actor previously. He could present things better. Pope Benedict is a person who acts thoughtfully, someone with whom you can address every question. I have met few people who listen like he does, who tackle every issue and express concern as he does. This is what Pope Benedict can deliver. Naturally, he's much more the theologian. That last time I was with him, I asked him about his second book on Jesus. I saw how happy he was with the question. Yesterday, as I handed the manuscript back, I understood the world he comes from, one a pope is allowed to come from.
When Cardinal Ratzinger was elected as Benedict XVI, almost all Germans said, "Now we are the Pope." A few years later, though, it looks as though many have turned cold and disillusioned toward him. Do you have an explanation?
It was definitely a big surprise that a German, after the Second World War, after so many hundreds of years, became Pope. After we as Germans absorbed it, there was great joy. Yes, we are Pope. We felt it at World Youth Day in Cologne and during Pope Benedict's visit to Bavaria, where I accompanied him. It was wonderful. Then there were decisions that not everyone understood, like the issue of the Pius brothers, where, without knowing it, he lifted the excommunication for Bishop Williamson. He told me himself that he wasn't aware of Williamson's remarks. This had the consequence that some people distance themselves from the Pope.
Is the Catholic Church in Germany, perhaps in Western Europe, a shrinking congregation?
We're getting smaller as a church. We're sharing the fate of the Protestant church in Germany and partially in Europe. I'm not happy about it, but we also share the fate of big organizations like unions or political parties. People are finding it more difficult to enter into commitments or maintain them. That affects the church, too. People are no longer being born and baptized in one of the two main churches. It's now a personal decision. There is greater choice compared to earlier, when I think of my own childhood. We have to recognize this reality, that we are getting smaller. But I'm also experiencing a lot of people engaging voluntarily, people who carry the church within themselves, and the number of people coming to services is growing, so this gives me hope.
Would you describe Germany as a secular country in which religious traditions and old values are disappearing?
Germany has become a country for missionaries. We have the job of proclaiming Christianity anew. We do have many things that have made Germany more secular. All the same, I'm convinced that what defines the people and the country is the Christian tradition, Christian roots. It's what defines our state and society. And, thank God, there's more at play behind the scenes and within people than is sometimes apparent.
Christianity is growing outside Western Europe, for example, in Africa, where it's very much alive. Will the energy for renewal come from other parts of the world?
Last year I was in Nigeria, in Africa, the year before Korea, and I was also in Latin America. Every time I was impressed by how joyfully Christians live their faith, how they celebrate Mass. We're also seeing many adults being baptized in Korea because they're looking for meaning. And why shouldn't we take inspiration and learn from these countries?
Archbishop Zolic, from a global perspective, Christians are probably the most persecuted faith group. Do you feel powerless because of the suffering of your fellow believers?
It is shocking how many Christians are persecuted today, or at least discriminated against. It is the case in Asian and Arab countries. Personally, I'm convinced that we need religious freedom, that every person can decide for themselves how they believe in God. It's important for me. We guarantee this freedom for people here, and we have to demand it in other countries. Very little is actually known about the extent to which Christians are discriminated against and persecuted. It's a dark side in the 21st century. It shouldn't be that way.
An important theme for Pope Benedict is ecumenical relations with the Orthodox Church and also with Protestants. And dialogue with Islam is also important for him. Is there progress on that front?
I personally consider it necessary to engage in dialogue with Islam. It will be tough. In Nigeria, I met some Muslim leaders that I could get on well with. Recently, the Grand Mufti of Damascus and I discussed the issue, but much effort is required because it is not necessarily something that's immediately apparent to many Muslims. I've been encouraged by the steps taken. There's no other option. It shouldn't be a question of Islam and Christianity fighting, but rather the two improving the lot of people and peace in the world.
Your Excellency, thank you for talking to us.